The next thing we're going to deal with is the oil pump. This is the new one. It's a Melling M55. Old one was too, but some cheap insurance here. This is the new drive shaft with this steel bushing. This is never going to break, never going to come off, never going to cause any issues. This oil pump came with a new plastic one that would fit on the original drive shaft. It would probably be good, and it has to be made of better materials than the 80s ones. This is the one that came out of the engine. You can see it's got a big crack running down it. So it would be bad news if this ever completely failed and the bushing came off. As you can see, the only thing holding the drive shaft in there is that bushing. It couldn't get too far out of place, but when you have something spinning real fast like this, you want it where it's supposed to be. So for $9 or whatever, you have this steel pump drive shaft that's never gonna fail. And even if this engine blows up, I'll use it on something else. And so here's the pickup that we modified. I cleaned that off super well, and we're gonna pop the cover off this oil pump so we can grease it. That's what a brand new oil pump looks like. You'll note there's no oil or grease in here other than just a little tiny bit, probably to keep it from rusting. So you really don't wanna let the oil pump run dry. So a small block Chevy oil pump is as simple as it gets. It gets pulled up from the pan through the pickup tube, runs into the inlet here. It comes out on the back side of these rotors here, all the way back here, and it gets pushed all the way around the periphery here, all the way around the edge, down through the main cap and into all the oil galleys. And we'll put a good amount of assembly lube in here. A lot of old school guys where you use like Vaseline, petroleum jelly kind of stuff and just completely pack it all the way full. I'm not gonna do that, I'm just gonna use assembly lube, but it should be just fine. So this will really help it for that initial break-in. So what I think is going to work is going to be to clamp the pickup in the vise, grip on the lip of it there, and we'll take our pump cover and line it up. Some guys will use Loctite here. I'm tempted to, but since we have this, and I'm pretty sure it's not going to crack or anything, we'll just put some oil on here and make sure it's going on the right direction. So hopefully this tab will get us close or even, you know, dead on. But if it's not quite right, we're gonna have to come back in and kind of bend everything a little bit. And we could definitely bend this. I'm just hoping it's all gonna wanna move when it's together. Cover this for the sake of cleanliness. Get a little farther. That will do it. That's all she wrote. Pretty tight, doesn't really easily want to rotate, so that's good. So we've got oil on all these bolts and assembly lube on the inside of the cover. So now we will put everything back together. The bolt even lines up with the tab we made, which is good because I did not try that until this very moment. Torque lows to 80 inch pounds. What I like to do, especially with this little torque wrench and on like lower settings, is actually just clamp the end of it in the vise and get a feel for what that click is gonna feel and sound like. Now let's make sure everything still spins okay. Definitely harder now with the assembly lube. Seems to be spinning a-okay. I guess I kinda didn't mention what the drive shaft does. The oil pump drive shaft connects the oil pump all the way through the main, through the block, and to the distributor. And just put a little one here and drop that in. And then try to line this up. And I'm just gonna put a little engine oil on this mating surface. On the drive shaft and on those alignment dowels. And then we will oil and install the oil pump bolt to the main cap. Just want to make sure the drive shaft isn't bound up or anything. No, that's good. And then this gets torqued to 65 foot-pounds. So now we have to check the pump to pan clearance. But before we could put the pan on, we also have to install the rear main seal housing. And while we're doing things in a weird order, because that's how my brain works, I want to put the fuel pump block-off plate on, just to get rid of parts and because this is staring at me. And what I'm going to do is spray this with WD-40, which will make this gasket much easier to get off if if I want to take it off in the future. Which I might well, because if that electric pump fails, I'm just putting a mechanical pump in this thing. And I'll just get these nice and tight. These bolts seemed a little long, so that's why there's two split locks on them. And yeah, split locks don't do anything. You don't need to tell me about it. And for the same reason, I want to install the oil filter adapter. I'm using WD-40 again, because I'd like to take this out and get the remote oil filter set up sooner or later. And I hate not using bolts with washers, but just because of the amount of space available here between this surface, I really wouldn't want to take any chances. Now let's get the new rear main seal installed. This has a specific note on the package saying it has to be bottomed out in the housing and it should be recessed approximately 0.09 inches when it's installed all the way. And this sits on the block like that. Yeah, so it goes in this direction. So you always have this oil lip pointing towards your oil. So we're gonna put some Loctite on to seal this ring in. We gotta get everything nice and clean. There's specialty stuff for this application, but I don't have any on hand. Regular Loctite will do a-okay. Okay, now with the thread locker on there, I'm just gonna take this wood, try to get it in there straight. Okay, let's wipe off the excess Loctite. We'll definitely make sure there's none on the sealing surface. And then we'll check the depth. This is a stack of 94. Okay, we'll give that Loctite a little while to set, and then we will get it onto the crank. So now you remove the oil pump pickup you just installed because you don't want to smash it. Okay, and now let's try to get this installed on the crank. There you go. Okay, and I've oiled all these bolts for reasons. The important thing when wrenching or really doing anything is to know your limits. I forgot to install the seal for this rear housing. There's a limit to how late at night you should do these kinds of things. Okay, at least notice that. And we'll put the oil pickup back on. Sure, why not a little more? Now we're back to this point. First things first, let's try to clean these bearings the absolute best we can one last time. Let's do a little comparison between the camshafts. This is the old one that just came off the engine, and this is the new one. And again, this is a very mild grind RV style camshaft. It's initially hard to spot the differences because they are pretty minor. This is not far from the stock one. If you take a side view, you can see that the lobes on the new one are a bit sharper and they come up higher than the lobes on the old one. If we hold up a straight edge, we can measure the total lift on these lobes. Seems like it can just fit 39 thousandths. The new cam just about fits the 22 feeler gauge, 0.022. So the lift on this lobe is around 0.017 inches taller than the lift on this lobe. That was sort of just to prove that they're different cams, but this is slightly bigger than this one. So now we'll clean up our cam the best we can, try to get off any factory coatings or anything that's on there. So this cam didn't come with any specialty break-in lube, so we're just going to use this Moly break-in lube. Moly's kind of old school stuff. It'll kind of make a mess in your pan, especially if you use more than you have to. but it'll help everything break in quickly and easily. So for break-in, we're gonna use a combination of MOLLE and the assembly lube. So I've got MOLLE on the lifter lobes and assembly lube on the main journals. And we'll try to get this to go in without mixing the two. There we go. Now let's rotate the crank to get that timing mark vertical. Okay, and we'll do the same thing for the cam. Marks are lined up, and that slack is pretty good. So we're gonna use medium strength thread lock. And these bolts, a fair amount of it there. Probably way too much. Definitely way too much. And torque them to 20 foot-pounds. Now everybody moves this one, I think. It'll be just fine. It'll break in some and get a little more loose than that, but these gears are in really good shape, so I think that'll be perfect. You want to give the whole thing a couple of rotations and make sure those timing marks still line up. Perfectly lined up. So I think this is all ready to get buttoned up in the front. So I've rotated the engine so that this piston is at top dead center. And what we're going to do is try to guess the distance between the block deck and the top of the piston. To do that, I'm just going to use a straight edge and feeler gauges. 3.5. 3.5 is a pretty tight fit. And then we'll check the same thing on another piston, just for kicks. So the piston to deck clearance is somewhere around 0.033 inches. We'll also have to account for the 30 over, for the head gasket thickness, for a couple other things. But we should be able to calculate the compression ratio pretty accurately. One thing you could do is dunk the whole chain in oil before assembly, but we're just gonna sprinkle some oil over it. That'll be just fine. That's enough of a mess, thank you. So with the cam installed, and after rotating everything a bit more, it seems like it takes right around 25 foot-pounds to get the thing moving. And now we'll install the front seal on the timing cover, and we'll use some Loctite around the edge of this thing, same way as the rear seal. This timing cover is actually the one from the other 350 I have here, because it was in slightly better shape. But this seal had been gray permatexed in here and was real hard to get out. I just had to use channel locks and bend the thing until it kind of slipped out. So I'm just hoping I didn't bend this at all, and it looks okay. Hopefully no leaks from this. Is a little too big. This is out of a ball joint press kit, and it is a pretty good fit for that. Oh, you can see, gotta be careful about this. I knocked the spring out of that seal. We're gonna have to get that back in there and make sure it stays in there. For this, I'm gonna take some assembly lube and make a great big mess of this. Because what you really don't want is that spring coming out once it's installed on the balancer. You really want to make sure that spring stays in place, otherwise you will have lots of oil leaks. Okay, now that we're all set up front, we're going to put the timing cover on. And we will set the cover on there. Stay. Use oil. And these bolts. Next we'll snug those up and tighten them to 80 inch pounds. Okay, the timing has been covered. Now I want to get the oil pan situated. So the best way to check screened pan clearance is to use something soft that'll compress and stay compressed, like putty or clay. I don't have that. I'm gonna figure something else out. The tin foil over the pickup just prevents anything from getting stuck in a screen. So we're gonna use another specialty item for this. Creamy. Man, this stuff is tacky. Maybe I should just use this to lubricate the bearings next time. Okay, so we've got a nice tall pile. And let's see how big a mess we can make. Put another piece here, just to hopefully make it easier to clean the pan up.
There's just the tiniest bit of gasket sticking up here. Just gonna take a razor blade and cut it off flush.
And then we'll drape on the same Felpro oil pan gasket that we had used last time on this engine. And we'll pull it back off carefully. There is our delicious oil pickup to pan clearance. Because of the angle list, it's a little funny, but it's about a quarter of an inch back here and just under a half inch up in the front. So the center is right around 3/8, which is perfect because that's what you want. The way this oil pan is set up, the half an inch at the front wouldn't even be a problem anyway. We'll double check this just because peanut butter is maybe not the most reliable of resources here.
About an inch tall mound there.
Drop this on carefully.
Hanging on it pretty hard. Lift it off carefully.
This tells me for sure that the pickup is not too far away from the pan. And gives me a pretty good idea of the actual distance. So in the interest of assuring a good seal, I've cleaned this off with brake clean. We're gonna put just a little dab of RTV where this back cover meets the block on both sides. And the same thing where the block meets the timing cover. And then we'll install the oil pan gasket and oil pan, hopefully for good. If your pan uses these reinforcement rails, make sure you put those on first. And if you have a little clip like this that holds the coolant lines to the side of the engine, make sure you have that going on as well. We'll put a little bit of oil on these bolts and start getting them all in. Remember, you don't want to get everything too tight until you have all the bolts in. Great, so everything's torqued down. I'll come back again a little later and retorque all these, but this should be good to go. I'm also going to go ahead and tighten down the drain bolt so that I do not forget to. So now we're pretty much done on the bottom end. We can flip it back over. So we have what is called a short block assembly completed. A long block is now what we're gonna put together, which is the cylinder heads and the intake manifold installed.